And here we are. Often I like to close my eyes and imagine the sun hitting my face and imagine the cells of my skin taking in the sunlight, with sunlight causing chemical reactions that can make me feel better. It's crazy that there is out there a condition that occurs in all of us on different levels by which the sunlight or lack thereof can make us feel a different way. The sunlight makes humans, animals, feel better. It makes them feel more optimistic, and it makes them feel more alive. Now, a process so common, the sunlight hitting the earth, sunlight hitting your face, whether it's in the summer or the spring, and that new warm spring sun, or if it's that cold, almost absent, only light feeling of the winter, where the sunlight hits your face and it almost feels like the sunlight has no warmth because the air temperature is so cold. It's amazing that this process is so tuned in with the evolution of organisms that chemical reactions in your cells have evolved to occur only in the presence of sunlight. So I would urge you, as we go through this chapter, and I'm going to do my best to remind you in as many ways as possible, not to forget how extraordinary this process of the sunlight hitting the earth is, and how a reverence and gratefulness for its feeling and its presence are necessary for a full and happy existence. The gratefulness for the source of all things in the presence of this white light. A gratefulness of this experience, or a gratefulness of its presence, can lead you to even greater mastery of the concept of photosynthesis, of how amazing it is that plants can do such a thing, that the process actually occurs. And I'm not even going to speak to you about where this process originated from, except that we know its parts and we know how it works. But come with me on this journey through the amazing concept of taking sunlight and using sunlight to make the products of cellular respiration, CO2 and water, into these things that we know so well, sugars. So this idea of energy flow, we talked all about energy and we talked about entropy, and remember that in all chemical reactions, energy is lost at every single stage of energy transfer, right? When energy goes, when I eat pasta, part of that energy goes to providing work for the chemical reactions that are needed in all my cells and all my body. And some of that energy is lost as heat. And actually, a lot of that energy is lost as heat. And the crazy thing is that no matter what goes on or how much energy there is in the world, when there is a transfer of energy from one organism to another, very little of that energy is actually used. Most of that energy is lost as entropy, which is why we talked about the nature of the universe being disorder. The nature of the energy is to disperse throughout the surroundings, not to be contained. And so when we talk about the flow of energy, energy being lost at every single trophic level or feeding level, right? So the plants taking as much energy as possible from the sun to make energy in the form of ATP and structures like cellulose and starches. And all the chemical energy that's in them is eaten by insects and herbivores and other things. And only 10% of that energy can be used by the next organism feeding. And then that next organism basically is eaten up by another organism. And that organism that ate it only gets 10% of that energy. So it's amazing how much energy is lost to heat. Energy is lost as radiation. How much energy is lost as entropy. So never forget that. The idea that there's so much chemical energy bound up in plants in the world, and that actually most of the chemical energy that exists for living organisms is bound up in plants, but only a very small portion of that energy is available as you move through feeding levels or trophic levels. That's why there are so little predators out there. You're not going to find 10,000 wolves in an area. You're not going to find 80 hawks. You're not going to find 25 mountain lions in a very small area. Because there isn't enough available energy to those organisms to support the life of that organism. There's a reason why a mosquito may have millions of eggs, may lay millions of eggs, and why a snake only may lay 1 to 5. And there's a reason why there are only so many elephants in the world, because there isn't enough possible productivity in the form of plants in order to support large organisms that are basically very inefficiently losing energy through all their chemical reactions. So it's important to first talk about the oxygen revolution, all right, or how oxygen began to be created. Now, most of the environment initially, as Earth began to form 4.5 billion years ago, most of the atmosphere was carbon dioxide and methane gas and nitrogen. But the levels of oxygen in the air, the levels of the oxygen atom, O2, gaseous oxygen in the air, have increased ever since the Earth was formed, or more importantly, ever since the first cellular organisms. Now, these first organisms could do something crazy. They could take energy in the form of sunlight and make a high energy chemical storage molecule called glucose. They could take the energy from the sun and make sugars from them. They then took these sugars to make something we call ATP, which can be used to do many forms of cellular work. But as this was happening, that there was so much carbon dioxide in the atmosphere that the carbon dioxide was taken in by these organisms, made into sugars, and some of that energy, or some of that chemical energy, was released as oxygen. So the amount of oxygen in the air started to skyrocket and started to increase in the atmosphere. We wouldn't have been able to breathe. All organisms that carry out aerobic metabolism or cellular respiration would not have been able to survive on the Earth as it was between 4 and 2 billion years ago, because there wasn't enough oxygen in the air to support such a mechanism of energy production. So we're left with these really small photosynthetic bacteria called cyanobacteria that exist as in colonies. They weren't multicellular, they were colonial. meaning they existed together, but they were all working on their own. So this oxygen revolution led to the conditions that we now see on Earth today, which are enough oxygen in the air to support oxygen being used as the ultimate electron acceptor in cellular respiration, which occurs in the mitochondria of eukaryotic organisms. Now, one of the crazy things about photosynthesis is that it's not that much different from cellular respiration. It's crazy. Photosynthesis is a process that's all about electrons. It's all about electrons, all right? Just as cellular respiration was all about finding ways to take electrons and use them for their chemical energy, it's the same thing. Photosynthesis uses the same thing. Although the mechanisms are going to be slightly different, we're still going to find ways to use electrons to create a gradient, to create a hydrogen ion gradient, to make ATP. And at the same time, we're also going to produce electron carriers again, which are going to help us make more ATP, or, in this case, build sugars. Now, photosynthesis, the process itself, photosynthesis, using sunlight to synthesize things. And we're using sunlight to synthesize sugars. We're using the energy from sunlight to break up and take electrons from molecules so that we can use those electrons to make ATP, and then so that we can use these things to make lots and lots of sugar. These sugars are then used to carry out all the energy processes of the cell, or they could be used to make structures like bark and leaves and fiber and roots and things like that. So photosynthesis is an extremely important process. Every single thing that you eat, its source, its major source, is photosynthesis. Everything you eat, its source is photosynthesis. You eat meat, the meat was taken in and made by the energy from the animal, from plants. Or the animal ate another animal, but that other animal had to get energy from plants in order to sustain itself. The source is sunlight. The source is plants. Now, however you use plants as your clothing, as your housing, as your food sustenance, the plants are by far the most important sustainable mechanism of all living organisms on life. Plants provide all the necessary nutrients and energy that one needs to sustain themselves. We know that you cannot live entirely off meat and no plants. On the other hand, it is possible to live off only plants and no meat. And what does this say? Well, this says that the source of all energy for all organisms is plants. The source is plants. So let's never forget that process, that plants provide everything we need. They are the association. They are what allows us to be bound in community to the earth, the plants. Now, if we just think about biomass, about the amount of mass that organic material that exists on the earth, over 90% of all the biological matter mass on earth, 90% of it is from plants. Let's think about something else. Bacteria. The biomass of all the bacteria on earth are over 150 times the biomass of that in humans. The biomass, the biological matter made by bacteria, is 150 times that of the biomass of humans. If we look at simply something like krill, which are a shrimp-like organism that provide lots of food for other organisms in the sea, the biomass of krill in the oceans is over 2 times the biomass of humans. So think about the biomass of humans, number one, as being negligible to the biomass of plants. And the second thing is the impact that we have upon the earth. Now, krill having double the amount of biomass that humans have on earth probably have way less than 10% of the effect on the earth's processes as humans do. So think about that. How much of the earth's biomass is in humans, and how much of the earth's effect on the planet do we have? Think about that. Is it just think about what you think about it. And I'll think about it too. So photosynthesis is a process that occurs in the chloroplasts of plants. All right. Photosynthesis is a process where sunlight is used in the presence of oxygen, or carbon dioxide, sorry, and sunlight and water to produce chemical energy in the form of sugars. All right. So a couple important things to remember first are that, oh, we're going to get there. Let me bring this over here, change it up a little bit. Bring it beforehand. Sorry, I'm wasting your time right now. I didn't mean to be doing that. We think about the process of photosynthesis and where it occurs. The process of photosynthesis, it occurs in the chloroplast, which is a double membrane organelle with its own cytosol called the stroma. All right, that occurs in only plant cells. Does not occur in animal cells. Also, the chloroplast does not occur in prokaryotic cells, although prokaryotic cells, some prokaryotic cells are able to photosynthesize. All right. What you're seeing over here are these stacks here. This stack here is called a granum. A granum is a stack of thylakoids. All right. Each thylakoid houses all the necessary stuff to carry out the process of photosynthesis. And they have many stacks and many stacks of stacks. All right. So important thing is that the stroma is the space inside of the chloroplast. The chloroplast is the organelle where photosynthesis occurs. It's a double membrane, double lipid bilayer. It has these thylakoids, which contain everything they need for photosynthesis. And there are many stacks of thylakoids. Inside the thylakoids is this stuff called the thylakoid space. All right? The thylakoid space. And here we have granum. And many stacks are all called granum. Grana. What we're seeing here is many different chloroplasts, organelles, inside of a plant, and this part of the plant is definitely a photosynthetic part. This part of the plant is most definitely the top of a leaf surface where all the photosynthetic pigments are needed in order to carry out the processes. And it's also showing how much possible energy is made from the process of photosynthesis. Looking over here, we're looking at something called stomata, which is made of two guard cells, one up top, and if you can see the slit here, it's one on the bottom. These two guard cells are designed to regulate the exchange of water vapor, carbon dioxide, and oxygen into the leaves. Surrounded this is the leaf surface, the surface of the leaf. So these stomata are on the undersides of the leaves, and what they do is they regulate the movement of gases in and out. All right, which is crazy. And the way they work is by controlling their osmotic potential, control their water potential. These are open now. And when they're deflated, they close up. All right. So the process of photosynthesis occurs in plant cells, in the chloroplasts. And more specifically, there are two major processes that occur in what we call photosynthesis, the synthesis of sugars using sunlight. The two major processes are the light reactions and the Calvin cycle. Okay. The light reactions are an electron transport chain that is designed to reduce NAD plus and to make ATP, all right, in the presence of sunlight. The light reactions, they're also called the light dependent reactions because they only occur in the presence of sunlight. On the other hand, you have another process called the Calvin cycle. Now, the Calvin cycle is kind of like the TCA or Krebs cycle, where it is a circular cycle meant to create something called G3P, which is going to be designed to make starches in the form of glucose, or can be made into other things by the cell. All right. It's also important to recognize that the Calvin cycle is basically going to take carbon dioxide and, using the energy made from the light reactions, is going to reduce and synthesize, anabolize, or build carbon into a more high-energy molecule using the energy taken from ATP and NADPH to create starches and sugars. All right. So remember, this process here is definitely an endergonic process. It's a process that requires energy. Where does the energy come from? It comes from ATP and NADPH. That is, that these things are coming from the light reactants. So they're inexplicably linked to one another. Our ingredients are sunlight, water, carbon dioxide, and many other nutrients along the way. Although, understanding that sunlight, carbon dioxide, and water are the main ingredients to create sugar and oxygen, which will be our waste product. All right. One of the really great things that may help you understand this process a little more is always to be comparing it to cellular respiration. Always compare photosynthesis to cellular respiration. It'll allow you to figure out the differences between them and will also allow you to understand the processes and how they're connected. Cellular respiration breaks down sugars to release carbon dioxide and water. Photosynthesis builds sugars and needs carbon dioxide and water. So every time I breathe out carbon dioxide, that carbon dioxide is entering the air and at some point will be taken in by plants to make their structures. Plants, on the other hand, release oxygen. That same oxygen is taken in by your cells in your breath and used to accept electrons so that ATP can be made from the energy that you ingest. All right. Cellular respiration occurs in the cytosol and the mitochondria. Photosynthesis occurs in the chloroplasts, both in the stroma and in the thylakoid space and thylakoid membranes. Now, you're going to have a new molecule here. It's called NADPH. I call it NAD plant H. But basically, it's NADH, which is, if you know, I hope to the sun that you know that NADH is an electron carrier, all right? NADPH is an electron carrier, but it's only used in the photosynthetic portion of energy production. NADPH is nicotinamide adenosine dinucleotide phosphate hydrogen, whereas NADH is nicotinamide adenosine dinucleotide hydrogen. With the only difference is a phosphate group. If you notice here, this is NADPH. And this is NADH. If you look, you're going to see that there's a phosphate group down here off of the number 2 carbon of this ribose sugar, all right, which doesn't occur over here on the NADH. All right, so that's one difference. We're still going to use ATP. Again, ATP is the energy currency of all living organisms, and you'll find it wherever energy is made or used, you will find NATP. You'll find ATP everywhere. Just kind of a revamping of what ATP is. ATP is made of adenine, which is a nitrogenous base. As you can see, there are many nitrogens in these rings here. And also it's made of a sugar called ribose that links the phosphates together. We have 3 phosphate groups. The major energy release and energy absorption part is going to be between the 2nd and the 3rd phosphate. All right, and we know all about that. So NADPH is going to be our new electron carrier in photosynthesis. All right. So, some overview on the process of photosynthesis. There's 2 major parts: the light reactions and the Calvin cycle. All right. Now, I want you to close your eyes. I want you to imagine a tree. All right. So imagine that tree. Taking a deep breath. Breathe it out. You've just breathed out carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide is floating in the air. At some point, look to the very top of some tree around you. And actually, there are no leaves on the trees right now, mostly. But some trees actually are photosynthesizing right now, like the evergreens. All right. And the carbon dioxide goes into the stomata of the guard cells of the leaves and is going to enter the plant cell. Once it enters the plant cell, it will then be used to create sugars. So that carbon dioxide that you breathed out someday, somehow, it's going to enter some plant in some way to produce sugars. All right, so there's 2 parts, the light reactions and the Calvin cycle. The light reactions, all right, are going to be occurring on the thylakoid membrane, all right, the membrane of the thylakoids, all right. Now, the light reactions need light to occur, all right? So the proteins of the electron transport chain is what we call the light reactions. They basically are an electron transport chain. We call it photophosphorylation, all right? It's the same thing as the electron transport chain in cell respiration, except where are you going to use light to phosphorylate ATP and reduce NADP+. All right. The light reactions occur on the thylakoid membrane. They also occur partially in the thylakoid space, and part of them, the light reactions, actually occurs in the stroma. All right. What goes into the light reactions are ADP here plus PI, NADP+, water, and sunlight. All right. What comes out of the light reactions are ATP, NADPH, all right, and oxygen. The other part of the photosynthesis is the Calvin cycle. The Calvin cycle is the major reductive part of photosynthesis. All right, we also call these the light-independent reactions because they can occur even if light doesn't exist. All right, they still need the things from the light reactions to occur, but if all these things are made and it's dark out and it's nighttime, we still do not need the light reactions to be occurring. So the light reactions occur in the presence of sunlight. The Calvin cycle does not directly need sunlight to occur. The Calvin cycle occurs in the stroma. All right, carbon dioxide goes in, ATP goes in, and NADPH go in. All right, and what comes out is going to be sucrose. All right, sucrose is going to be, or glucose, G3P is glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, which we remember from glycolysis, is going to be made into glucose, sucrose, fructose, and whatever other sugars need to be made from this stuff.